All right, that's fine. Unless somebody wanted to say a little prayer. Anybody in the mood to do that? That's open to everyone as well. All right, we'll just have, let me get to the agenda. Give me 1 second, please. All right, we're gonna open up with a moment of silence, so then we'll go into the Pledge of Allegiance. All right, thank you, everyone. We're gonna now recite the Pledge of Allegiance. We'll take a moment for those who would like to stand. We should all stand. All right. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, everyone. And we apologize to everyone for our late start this evening. Linda, we're going to go on to a roll call, please.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Here.
Ms. Gubin-Hendershitz?
Here.
Mr. Marmorou?
Here.
Ms. Reed?
Here.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Here.
Ms. Ventura?
Here.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Here.
7 present, none absent.
All right, we're going to try to get through, I know we have a couple presenters, let's try to get through this agenda quickly. There were executive sessions on March 1st, Committee of the Whole regarding personnel, and that was per the Pennsylvania Sunshine Act, Title 65, Section 708, Executive Sessions A1. There are no proclamations or presentations this evening. Linda, we had previously mentioned there being 3 public speakers. Are they on the line that you're aware of?
2 are present.
2 are present. So
yeah, just
before we get started, we're going to ask Donna to please read the public comment guidelines.
Okay, thank you, Mr. President. Due to COVID-19, also known as the coronavirus, the public speaking requirements have been modified. Public comment can be offered by telephone or virtual meeting application, by registering with the city clerk by noon the day of the business meeting, or writing through an email to council@readingpa.gov or a letter mailed to the council office clearly marked, quote, public comment, unquote. Written public comment must be submitted by 5 p.m. the day of the meeting to allow time to distribute the comments submitted. The written comment will be read into the record. All remarks must be directed to council as a body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Any comment that is personally offensive or impertinent will not be read into the record. Comments on agenda matters are limited to 5 minutes in length, and comments on non-agenda matters are limited to 3 minutes.
All right, Donna, thank you. Linda, who's our first speaker, please?
Mr. Butler is first. He's speaking on the city's youth commission.
All right, Mr. Butler, welcome. And you have up to 3 minutes this evening.
Hello, good evening, council. My name is Winston Butler II. I am a constituent of District 4. Tonight, my question is regarding the youth council, and I would like to know the status of the council. And also, I know we submitted our clearances in January, but as far as what the next steps are. Thank you.
All right, Winton, thank you, sir. We will have a brief opportunity for people, for council members to comment at the end of the public comment section, and then a more extended opportunity towards the end of the meeting. We don't normally directly interact with the speakers. So we have one more speaker, and then we'll open it up for anybody to give you some immediate comments. Linda, will you please announce the next speaker?
The next speaker is Mr. Cintron, and he's speaking about La Makina, which is a bar located at 1570 Cotton Street.
All right, Mr. Cintron, welcome. You have up to 3 minutes, sir.
Yes. Good evening, board, and grateful for this opportunity. I spoke with my councilwoman, Marsha Goodman-Hendershitz, and she was very kind to help us to get a petition to go around the neighborhood. Basically, this bar, since it's been open during COVID, has been operating above capacity. It's not a restaurant. It is basically after hours. People are throughout the community are up at arms. They're coming in intoxicated. leaving beer bottles and trash all around, blocking in our vehicles. They're urinating in public. They're basically super loud. So between the hours of 11:30 to 3:30, there's no peace within a 3 to 4 block radius. Vehicles, several vehicles on 16th, 15th and a half, 15th have been struck, hit and run. And when the police are called, basically the police said there's nothing they could do. When we call, obviously, because people cannot get in or out of their driveways, there's public parking and there's private parking. They're coming and taking over everything and actually blocking whole city streets. We don't have, the police are unable to respond. It's an ongoing thing Thursday, Fridays, and Saturdays. They try to help as well as they can, but it's, we've also, as we were going through, we got over almost 100 signatures for the establishment to get shut down. And one thing that we did find out this weekend during getting the signatures is that there's prostitution, was told to us that prostitution is happening on the second, on the apartment above it, which is connected with it as well.
All right, Lewis, thank you again for your comments. Again, council members will have an opportunity for a brief response here at this moment and or later on at the end of the meeting. Is there a council member that has an immediate need to respond to either one or both of the speakers at this time? Lucine.
Yes, very quickly to address Mr. Butler's question. We do have a planning meeting regarding the Youth Commission this Thursday. It's an internal meeting scheduled for 5 p.m. with the potential coordinators. And we were waiting to schedule that to receive the clearances that you did mention. And so I would say we're well on our way and we thank everybody who has been patient. Some of the original applicants no longer qualified for various reasons, and we had to make sure that we had a full complement to begin the commission. So thank you for asking your question this evening, and we look forward to engaging with you and the others very soon.
All right, any other additional comments at this time? Marcia?
Okay, I wanted to first of all thank Mr. Centron for taking a leadership role in the community, listening to the neighbors. This is an unacceptable and horrendous situation that really impacts on the safety and the security. I know that I've spoken with Chief Tornelli. He is doing what needs to be done. There are some many questions out there, including the latest with the prostitution. It is not something that can continue. And I would hope that the administration is doing what it needs to do, working together with all law enforcement partners. This has been a safe and secure neighborhood until this bar, and I'm even questioning whether or not they have a liquor license at this point. That's being looked at. So I would hope that within the next week, we can have some more concrete answers to the community and that we start seeing the action being taken that's visible. I know there may be things that are going on behind the scenes, but the neighbors have a right to have a visible response to their concerns. And one of the things that wasn't mentioned that we also know is happening is after closing hours, there has been gunfire in the community. And I've heard it from my home because I live only a block and a half away from this location. So it's unacceptable. So thank you. And I hope that we don't have these kind of things happening in other neighborhoods, but we need to react immediately. I don't know whether anyone from the administration has any comments they'd like to make.
Well, Marcia, I don't want to turn this comment response. We can address that during the administrative reports, but this is just our brief response to public comments.
Okay, thank you.
If anybody else have any immediate need, again, if somebody's already referenced it on the body, we try to limit it here. There will be an administrative report period in a very short term here in this same meeting. If council doesn't object, I would like, first of all, does anybody else have any comments on the public speakers? If not, I would like to see if no one objects because of the late hour, I'd like to move up the two presentations from both the Charter Board and the Convention Center Authority. Is there any objection to me doing that? If not,
nope.
Okay, great. So we have first Shay McFarland for just a high-level recap of what's going on with the Charter Board, accomplishments, needs, et cetera, key points of your operations. Is Shane available?
Yes, I am.
Hi, Shane. Welcome and good evening. The floor is yours for an overview on the charter board.
All right. Thank you, Council President. If I may ask, how much time do I have? I know it's late.
We'd like to say 10 minutes is at the most. So if you could get it in at 6 or 7, that gives us a few minutes for questions. We do have a long agenda tonight. I know you're probably tired too.
Understood. Sounds good. All right. Let me first say happy International Women's Day to all the ladies on the panel. I really appreciate your hard work here in Reading. And I must say, Councilwoman Johanny, you're my district representative, and I really admire your passion for this city. So thank you very much for your leadership. All right, with that said, let me start by saying that the Charter Board very much welcomes this accountability procedure. I want to talk briefly about the board's functions, and in doing so, I'll delve into the board's most recent activities relative to those functions, and then I will try to finish off by speaking about how the board moves forward and what we are, our main focus is moving forward. Many of our seasoned councillors may already understand that, may already understand these functions very well, but I also recognize that we do have a relatively new councillors who may not have had the opportunity to go through the charter orientation process. With that said, I will take a few minutes, and I promise I'll make it real quick, just to speak about the importance of the charter itself, not the charter board, but the governing document. I've had many questions asked to me about why is it important? Why is the Home Rule Charter important? And for me, the answer is simple. Without the charter, self-governance is simply a theoretical notion. Prior to 1996, the charter under which a city was governed was created by the state, and hence it was also enforced by the state. In 96, when the city of Reading adopted the Home Rule Charter, self-governance then became a practical concept. Under this charter, the city was able to restructure its government and, most importantly, create and enforce legislation. The charter clearly outlines the rights, responsibilities, and limitations to self-governance. And the latter concept of government limitations is very important. Our charter, which with all its given privileges, its rights, responsibilities, and limitations, essentially creates a stable government under which the city can operate and self-sustain. In other words, strict adherence to the charter is important to government stability. And unfortunately, what we've witnessed in Reading in the last decade is where a simple charter violation has led to a little bit of instability and some ineffective governance. To be frank, a simple charter violation can have huge socioeconomic and political impacts. We need not look too far for examples. As a result, I do believe that we must keep in mind that political cynicism, and as it relates to Reading, the perception of political cynicism is emboldened each time there is a charter violation, and no matter how simple it is. Nevertheless, shortly after the city of Reading adopted the Home Rule Charter, the people of Reading were quite concerned that the department responsible for enforcing charter provisions could one day become the subject of a charter violation and investigation. I can only presume that there were concerns about possible conflicts of interest. So the people of Reading decided through a ballot referendum to create a separate independent entity with responsibilities of enforcing charter provisions. And that entity that was created by referendum is the Charter Board. The Charter Board has three functions. One, to educate, advise, and enforce. As it relates to enforcement, the way the process works is a city resident, employee, or official may submit a complaint to the Charter Board relating to a possible charter violation. Once the complaint is received, our investigating officer will vet the complaint to establish jurisdiction. If jurisdiction is not established, meaning the complaint is not related to the charter, then the complaint is dismissed. On the other hand, if jurisdiction is established, then at that point, the investigating officer will move forward with a thorough investigation. It's important to note that at this point in the process, the board is only notified of the investigation. The board is not privy to the nature of the complaint, the complainant, or the subjects of the complaint. At the end of the investigation, the board is presenting a findings of facts report. Only at that point are we briefed on the subject, the nature of the complaint, and the complainant, at which point we will convene, evaluate the facts based on the findings, and then we will make a final decision. In terms of enforcement numbers over the last 10 years, the board has issued approximately 8 final orders. Among those 8 final orders, 2 were issued in the second half of the last administration. Among those 8 final orders, less than half were appealed in the Court of Common Pleas, and all were either fully sustained or dismissed in part only. As it relates to our second function, the Charter Board also provides advisory opinions to city officials. City officials may submit a question for an advisory opinion related to the charter. It's important to note that it's best if the question presented to the board is prospective in nature rather than retrospective. In terms of advisory opinion numbers, over the last 10 years between 2010, 2020, the Charter Board has issued approximately 30 advisory opinions, where I would say 14 or 15 of those opinions were issued in the last administration alone. And I'm trying to make it real quick. In terms of our last function, is our education function. And I do believe this is our most important function. The board provides charter-related education to city officials, employees, and officials. At least that's what we should be doing. Unfortunately, besides our duty to provide occasional orientation to newly elected and appointed officials, the board has not been proactively pursuing any education initiative for the last 10 years. And after speaking with the former chair on numerous occasions about this, I could only conclude that there was a perception among board members that any education initiative outside of orientation would have been inextricably tied to city expenses. And because of that, the board was always reluctant to pursue any education initiative at all. However, as new chair, I have a much different outlook. I believe this is our most important function, which if we pursue with a little bit of diligence and creativity, will only cost city officials 5 minutes of their reading time per month. The board currently initiatives tabled. The first initiative is a short newsletter called Tip of the Month. The idea behind this initiative is to distribute a short newsletter to city officials consisting of facts related to charter provisions. And the second initiative is called the Annotated Charter. And this one we're very excited about. It's not a novel idea to the Charter Board. We've been pursuing this initiative for the last 10 years. In fact, it's currently in the making. But for the last 5 years, because of funding, it has been paused. The idea behind the annotated charter is to link each advisory opinion and the final order to the applicable provision within the charter through an indexing system. The goal is to provide each city official an annotated charter at the end of each year. This, I believe, will be our most important education tool going forward. And in closing, I must say that the charter must and will do a better job to educate all stakeholders, not only on charter provisions, but on the history and importance of this document and how it has made Reading a better place since 1996. Thank you.
All right, Shay, thank you very much for the presentation. We appreciate all the information. We're gonna open it up. Does any council member have any questions or comments at this time? Johanny.
Thank you so much, Shane, for that presentation. It was pretty, although it was condensed, it was very informative. My question is, so how often should elected officials be should be exposed to the orientation, even though, I mean, should it happen annually, just as a refresher? Like, what is the recommendation?
That's a very good question, Johanny. Generally, what would happen is once we have newly elected or appointed officials, I believe the clerk's office would reach out to us and notify us of those appointments. And then we would go ahead and try to secure a date to have those individuals orientated. However, due to COVID, we didn't have the opportunity to do orientation for newly elected officials. To answer your question, it's a very good question. And I do believe it's something that we should have a broader discussion about. At this point, I could not give you a direct answer to your question, but it's something that I will bring to the board and we will discuss it, and I will definitely get back to you.
All right, Donna, and then Lucy.
Just dovetailing on Johanny's question, I think that's provision in the charter that we're required to have that orientation. Marcia's shaking her head. I believe we are. I mean, I've always had it every time I start a term, if I'm fortunate enough to do that. And I also had it when I served on an authority and also on a commission before and during, between council terms. So I'm not quite sure. It should probably be happening on a regular basis, and it could probably happen via Zoom. But there was also a monetary remuneration for that as well. So that should really be happening every 2 years and happening every time a new department head comes in and things like that. That should be an ongoing thing, to my understanding and my knowledge.
All right. Lucy, did you have a comment, or was your hand just?
No, I'll comment. Shane, thank you so much for your abbreviated presentation on a very, very important topic. Thank you for the work that you do, and to the other members of the board. I appreciate your suggestions on education outreach. I too believe that it's critical. I look forward to seeing the newsletter and possibly to the annotated charter that you've spoken of this evening. I know that even with the charter review board that I think occurs every 5 years, still, we see too much ambiguity and uncertainty as we shouldn't in when we're referring to the document that governs and guides us as a city. So we rely on you and appreciate the work that you're doing. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, if there are no additional comments, we are going to thank you, Shane, for the update, and we look forward to your continued your service to the city, and we're very appreciative of it. And you know, hopefully we don't need to use your services much, but when we do, we know they're being well catered to, right? So thank you. All right,
thank you guys. Have a good, take care.
Thank you, Shane. We're going to move on to we have the Honorable Mr. Fucci here this evening, former councilman, the Honorable Mr. Ellerman, and the Honorable Mr. Gambar. Oh boy, we got three mics, so we're wondering, you know, did we do something wrong, first of all?
Three mics and an Izzy.
Yeah, you all look great. Mr. Ellerman, you look great. Haven't seen you. I'm glad you're safe and you're staying protected. Haven't seen you for a while, but I remember when Mike and I were at BARDA before the building even went up, and we were watching the traffic demos. And Mike was patient for the first half hour. But remember, Mike, what we were watching were dots going across the screen for like 50 minutes. And I thought, uh-oh. These dots better speed up a little bit, because it's going to get testy here. But glad to see you guys. I don't know who wants to lead
Jeff,
the way.
Jeff, we have Izzy too, so don't forget.
Oh, we have Izzy as well. Right. Wow. Sorry. Yes.
Just, so we just have has a wrong name under his thing.
Looks I don't like want to get Izzy back. He throws this Lord, right.
We cloned him.
Yeah. How you doing, sir? Good to see you.
Hi.
Great. And I don't know who's going to lead off from your team, but we welcome you all here this evening, and thank you.
Well, thanks, Jeff. This is Mike Gumbar here. I'll take the lead to start. And I do promise you that we all have different middle names. So we're not all the same after that. But thanks for your time. I do have, as you noted, Mike Fucci and Izzy here as well, too. The three of us, for the council members that aren't aware, we're the three appointed members of the authority by the City of Reading. The Convention Center Authority is a bit unique because it's a joint authority with the county as well. So the county appoints our other three members, and then the seventh member is a floating member that goes back and forth between the city and the county. Currently, that seat is with the county. So that's why the Mike Fucci and Izzy are here with us. And then Mike Ellerman is the chair of our authority. So he's here for moral support as well too. So for those who don't know, obviously our function is to operate and manage the Santander Arena and the Santander Performing Arts Center. Unfortunately, I don't think anybody has been anywhere near either of those venues in the last year or so. We are not happy about that, obviously, but we hope that the future has different plans in store for us so we can get back to normal. So I think it's been about 3 years since we've been here. So I just wanted to highlight some things that have been going on with the authority over that time. Obviously, the last year has been a challenge for us. We haven't had any events, obviously, in any of the venues at all. But the bigger issue that we're faced with is the decline in hotel stays. For those that aren't aware, we are supported large part by the hotel tax revenue. So when hotel room stays go down, so does our revenue. And, you know, that's not a good thing. So the last year has obviously been a challenge for us. The numbers are still in flux, and we don't have anything concrete at this point, but we're currently estimating that the hotel tax revenue drops somewhere around 40% to 42% on an annual basis. So that caused some challenges for us over the past year, but I am proud to report that the authority as a whole took some significant efforts to weather the storm. We worked hard with our bank to get deferrals on our principal debt repayments. We did work with the management team to restructure some of the fees that are being paid. The Royals hockey team was able to get some PPP funding as well too. So while it was a difficult year for us, I think we are in about as good a position as we possibly could be at this time. As you know, we're all sitting here right now, we're not really sure what the future holds, but we are optimistic. The vaccine seems to be ramping up, and you know, the numbers seem to be going down, so that's all positive. The governor did announce some limited restrictions last week to allow for some in-person attendance and outdoor and indoor events. Obviously, it's a low amount, but we're hoping, you know, as things get better, that can increase for us. The industry goal right now is we're looking at full capacity events, hopefully in mid to late fall. I know Mike Fucci will talk a little bit more about it when he gets into the Royals. In hopes of that happening, the authority did make a significant investment, close to $500,000 in costs and efforts, PPE, signage, and other things. So when we are ready to reopen, we're going to do it the right way. It will be safe. It will be clean. Everybody that's coming in the door, you know, will hopefully be able to enjoy, you know, whatever concert, show, sporting event that they're going to be attending, and not be compromised at all from a safety or health perspective as well. So, you know, we're proud about that. We're anxious for that to get into effect as well too. You know, prior to this year, the last 2 years have been pretty good. So, you know, we were gaining momentum. So this was a little bit of a speed bump for us, but we're again, hopeful for the future. I do have some interesting news. I'm sure some people on this call, you know, will remember Mr. Ellerman. I'm sure it feels like yesterday for him, but on September 6th of this year, we will actually be celebrating the 20th anniversary of the dedication of the arena. So unfortunately, we don't have anything special planned for that as we sit here today, because we can't plan anything, but you know, we are committed to doing, you know, a celebration when the time is right for that. So we're all looking forward to that. And the other thing, you know, beyond the events and the arena and the Performing Arts Center, you know, the authority does pride itself on its commitment to downtown Reading, its commitment to investing in the city and bringing people downtown to spend money, to create jobs, and just to be a good anchor, I would say, for that sector of the economy. So with that, we do our best to give back as well, too. We do make contributions on an annual basis over the years to the Brooks Art Council for the Jazz Fest and the Blues Fest. We also contribute to Downtown Alive. We're hopeful that that program can somehow continue in the future, you know, in whatever fashion that is, you know, and obviously we do our part with the high school graduations and high school sports as well, too. One of our bigger accomplishments over the last 3 years, I would say, would be the purchase of the Reading Royals in 2019 from Jack Gulati. At the time, there was threats of him moving the team outside of Reading. So, the authority thought it would be the best thing possible to step up, purchase the team to make sure that it stayed here, you know, as the anchor for the arena. So with that, I would turn it over to Mike Fiucci just to talk a little bit about the Royals and also the scholarships that the authority provides.
Thanks, Mike Gumbar. Hello, City Council. Hope everyone is doing well. I'm sure it's been a trying year for all of you also with the COVID. First thing I'd like to start with is our some positive news. We started this summer the Reading Royals Youth Hockey Program. And Linda has a little home page of our Reading Royals Youth Hockey that she can show. This program kicked off this past summer, and we have three programs with this for the kids. Learn to Skate, Skill Clinics, and Youth Leagues. And so far, we had over 400 kids participate between the three programs. This year, we're going to have some summer camps, and hopefully we'll be able to have some of those camps at the Santander Arena and more of them moving forward. The homepage for that is www.royalsyouthhockey.com. And most of our things are at the Body Zone right now. And it's been a really positive program, a lot of good feedback from parents and children. And we're only hope to grow this. Hopefully in a year or two, we'll be able to have some travel teams also. We're trying to build a program, but I think there's a need for that. We had that years ago with some travel programs, but I think we like to kick that off a little more. So, the Convention Center Authority is a sponsor of that also. So that's something else we're trying to, you know, stay involved with the community. Also, I'd like to touch on some stuff with the Reading Royals. Obviously, we could not play this year. The authority purchased the Royals back in 2019 from Jack Gulati. And as like Mark Gumbar said, we were concerned that he had possibilities of selling it to someone out of the area and moving the team. But we averted that. And last year, we were headed in the right direction. Attendance was up 30%. And we were in first place, and we were heading for a, I think, successful season. Our last home game was March 8th last year, and we had a couple of home away games after that, but we had a shutdown March 14th, I believe, and we had everything, we had the ice all green, we were going to have a St. Patrick Day weekend, we had two games scheduled, but all that got canceled because of the COVID. So this year we had to opt out for playing in ECHL. We were very limited from the governor's attendance for indoor arenas. So we obviously couldn't play. Some ECHL teams did play. 13 teams did play. 11 opted out. The 13 teams that played were mostly from the Midwest and South that could have more attendance. So that's, you know, the main reason why we didn't play. You know, the attendance is very limited. And we, you know, we just could not make it work with the limited attendance. So we do have some other good news for the Royals. We are scheduled our season to kick off next year, our 20th season, October 23rd, 2021. So hopefully we'll be having a full rink and hopefully many of you will be able to attend. The Flyers will still be our affiliate, which is a positive thing. Many Flyers fans in the community, and it's been a very good affiliation for us. And I think that's it for now on the Royals also. And we have not been able to do the scholarships this year because of financial reasons, and hopefully we will be able to pick that up next year. We give out two scholarships to local students. This is our Al Boscov scholarship in honor of him, but due to financial concerns, we put that on hold for this year, but we look forward to doing that again next year also. And with that, I'll open up for any questions, or Izzy might have a few things also to add.
All right. Thanks, Mike. Yeah, one of the other major highlights of the authority over the past couple of years, I think, is the fact that we were able to make significant completion of the renovations to the Pearl Vision building at the corner of 8th and Penn. So we don't have any end user at this point, but we do feel that that's going to be an integral part into the continued revitalization of downtown and the growth, you know, that's starting with Alvernia and the 400 block and extending all the way up. So I know Izzy's our resident real estate expert, so I thought maybe he'd be best to touch on that point for a little.
Right. Hi, everyone. So basically, I sell real estate for a living. And, you know, the Pearl Vision Center is, I think it's exciting. It's going to bring some great opportunities downtown. Also, a lot of traffic. People are going to want to come there and check that place out because it's beautiful. With everything going down at Alvernia, you know, it's starting to spread out. I mean, we are getting questions constantly on how many properties or where can we get a property downtown. People are excited about this stuff. So, you know, the word's out. You know, there's hardly any properties on the market. I think there's like 320 today on the market in all of Birch County. We're closing about 55 units in Reading. So Reading is actually doing pretty good. And since 2019, our prices have gone up almost 26% per unit. So the average price in Reading was actually 78,000 in 2019. Today's about 102 average. So, I mean, there's a lot of excitement about this stuff in Reading. And so I think the Pearl Vision Center is going to be a big hit. That's all I got.
Thanks, Izzy. Pretty much a summary of what we've done. Mike Ellerman, do you have anything to add?
Yes, Michael, just a couple of brief comments. I think first and foremost, as we look forward after a difficult period, we need to have in the Commonwealth the ability to operate at approximately 70% of capacity to break even. Very high overheads in the buildings that we have. It's more so in the arena than it is in SPAC. But until we get the ability to operate at a break even point, it's very difficult to take that step at a loss greater than we're incurring right now. So as the governor goes, we go on this issue. I think from the standpoint of the city, and Izzy talked about it a little bit, and what I will call a renaissance that is underway in the city, there is a very important aspect to the two facilities that we operate. For instance, we bring anywhere from 400,000 people, some years plus, to a low number of little over 200 in 20. That's a lot of people to bring downtown, and it's a heck of a drop. I think the other thing that is important to understand from the city standpoint, that when we were operating in 19 from strength, the parking and the fees that we pay on the amusement tax out of the buildings totaled about $550,000. But that dropped to 2.25 in fiscal 20. Incidentally, our fiscal year does end June the 30th year. So there are important things to the city as well as to our operations. And this past year,
Mike, you muted.
You got muted.
You got muted, Mike.
Appreciate that. I hit it by accident. But I think at this stage, we're set pretty well, as long as the governor comes through with an operating level that's sufficient. Our problem is unlike that of the baseball team. They're operating outside, so they'll get preference, but we're contained. And as a result, that's going to be touch and go. Our very big hope is that we can go back in operation September, October of this time year. And we need about 3 months to 3-4 months in some instances to staff back up. So many of our people we had to let go. We have a very skeleton crew right now. Do have a few people on furlough working every 2 weeks, fortuitously with the CARES money and now the new benefits coming from unemployment, we'll keep a couple of those people. But you know, there are certain jobs that are just absolute must to operate, whether it's booking, box office, and things like that, they're musts. And we're gonna have to undergo a lot of costs to reorient, start up, maintenance and everything, to go back in operations, particularly in the arena. Got a nice plant to take care of and all. So just a few comments, not to belabor you, and I'll shut up. Thank you.
Yeah, Mike, and Izzy, thank you, everyone. We do have a tight agenda. We'll open it up for a couple questions, but before we do that, I don't know the details of the recently, well, nearly passed stimulus package. My hope is that there could be some flow throughs either directly to your organization or through the city or county, depending on what that might look like, you know, to at least supplement, you know, everything else that you're going to try to do to get back to a full even pace. Mike, I don't know if you guys have watched that legislation, any thoughts on it, a real brief kind of feedback if you could, and we'll open it up to any critical questions. It's pushing it 20 for us, and we still have a whole agenda here. So
at this stage, the last approval in the old administration is very, very important to us. There is a large sum of billions of dollars that were put to get forth for what they call shuttered venues. Mm-hmm. We will qualify.
Okay, good.
The question is, will we receive?
Right.
And there are basically two classes. First class is if your revenue was down 90%, the way they define it, and this is very complicated. You go in with the first group of people.
Right.
If you're below 90%, you go with the second group. Right now, the preliminary numbers say we're on the border of the 90%. The final instructions are not out yet. They're coming through SBA. Preliminary numbers, preliminary rules came out on Friday. So we worked this weekend to see where we are.
Okay, well, that's
that is going to be far more important than the one that they just approved.
Sure. So we'll have to keep an eye on that and keep us posted. And there may be $2 from both the city and the county. We'll Abe and Mayor, well, the mayor's, I don't know, but we'll have to keep an eye on that as well. If in case there are dollars that we're able to channel your way. Obviously, it's important that we support both the center and the hotel downtown to as a base, a home base to everything else we're trying to accomplish. Guys, I know we're running late in time, but if there are critical comments or questions, we appreciate everyone's input. Does anybody have a critical comment or question that they'd like to get in at this time? Go ahead, Johanny.
I don't know if it's critical, but just a quick question regarding summer camp. I heard you're going to be running a summer camp for youth. What are their fees and how is the information being disseminated and getting out to folks?
Well, it's going through their website and Facebook also, and it's going out to schools, and it's kind of difficult, I guess, you know, the schools throughout the county and city, you know, I don't know how they can disseminate it, with some are on Zoom, some are in person. So we got the schools, we have Facebook, and we have our website. And the fees range anywhere from beginning $35 to full ICE program $400. So there's, it is a range here, but if you're just a clinic, it's $35 and then all the way up to $400 for a full ICE program.
Yes, this is Marcia. I wanted to make a comment just to add. The way that we have found, and I'm working with social service agencies and the schools, the best way to get out information at this point is to get to the Reading Rec, to get to the Olivets. They all serve meals. They put information in the packets that go out to the youth and the families. And you can be contacting both Chris Winters and Daphne Clare, and they'll tell you how to go about it. But it's a fabulous way, because the kids look in those packets when they take out their meals, they get the information.
All right. Any other critical questions? Donna?
Not so much critical, but I know we're all dealing with the changes and the restrictions of COVID, but I would encourage you, if there's any way that you can celebrate the 20th anniversary on or about the day. What always strikes me about that was that 5 days later, our country changed forever. And the joy that we felt from the 6th through what happened that following Tuesday was stunning. And I think we can all use some really happy news, because we know what's going to be celebrated or marked on the 11th of September. So if there's anything you guys can do, even if it's an outdoor thing or some kind of joyous thing, it would be nice to predicate the other anniversary that comes 5 days later. So I'm sure if there's anything we can do as any via the mayor's office or council, we'd be happy to assist.
Hard to believe it's been 20 years.
Good comment.
Yeah, hard to believe it's been 20 years. So, Jesus, Lord, we were just watching them dig the hole. We're getting old fast. I can speak for myself. My God. Anybody else have any comments? It's hard to believe, Mike, it's been 20 years. Lord. Anybody else have any comments? Lucine.
Gentlemen, thanks for your time this evening. I'm sorry we're rushed, but that doesn't diminish the information that you shared. And obviously the amusement tax is very important for us in our fiduciary roles and the city. I'm really happy to hear a little bit of an update on the Pearl Vision building. As you said, you are an anchor, both of the locations, and we see that footprint expanding with this revitalization, that even through this pandemic, we are prevailing as a city in that aspect. So I hope to see a really good anchor and tenant come in for that Pearl Vision building, that you're still making that a priority and actively engaging to bring that right person in. So thank you for doing that, and thank you for your work.
Nope.
Okay, any other critical
pleasure to be in service?
No. All right. Mike, Izzy, thank you very much for waiting around for us this evening and for your continued dedication. I know you all work hard, not only on the authority, but in everything you do. So we really appreciate it. It takes everybody's input to keep a city going in our region. So we appreciate it fully. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeff. Thanks, City Council. Thanks, Linda.
All right. Thank you, everyone. All right, Council, I'm going to move back up to the approval of our agenda and minutes. This will include the approval of tonight's agenda and the minutes from our February 22nd regular meeting and approving the summations of discussion from the February 22nd and March 1st Committee of the Whole and Nominations and Appointments Committee meetings. The approval of our agenda and minutes would also include the approval of our consent agenda. I'm going to try to read through this quickly. The first item is an award of contract for LTW for maintenance support services and software updates for the police VSU at the cost of $83,208.99. The next item is an award of contract to Vitra Systems in Tempe, Arizona to upgrade the current police simulation trainer at a cost of $69,249.54 for police marksmanship training. This includes a trade value of $10,000 for our current obsolete training system. The next item is authorizing the purchase of the Microsoft Server 2019 Exchange licenses to modernize the email communication platform used across the entire city government from Southern Computer Warehouse, a CoStars vendor, at the cost of $62,753.07, as authorized by the Ackman of Bill 68-2020. The next item under the consent agenda is a resolution authorizing the submission of a joint exercise zone application to the PEDCED, which offers a state tax incentive to stimulate economic development within communities. This was submitted by the Greater Redding Chamber Alliance and managed by the Greater Brooks Development Fund, and that was received this evening. The next item is a resolution authorizing the disposal of bid files, tabulations, purchase orders, invoices, and general correspondence for 2011 and 2012 for the purchasing division as per the retention and disposition schedule for records of Pennsylvania municipalities issued in 2009. The next resolution is authorizing the purchase of a 2021 Transit 150 cargo van from Thomasano Ford in Shillington, in the amount of $36,476.95 through the use of a Pennsylvania Cooperative Purchasing Program, CoStars. And the next item is the resolution G, by the way, is a duplicate of a previous of resolution E. So I'm going to move on to H. It's an award of contract for the replacement of the 11th and Pike playground fencing to ProMax Fencing in Reading, Pennsylvania for the full perimeter of the park at a cost of $40,725. Next resolution is authorizing the police chief to execute the letter of agreement with Tritech for support services for 1 year through March 22nd of 2022 and remit payment to Tritech Software Systems in a total amount of $134,693.33 for the provision of those services for police CAD, RMS, and police analytics for the police department. And the final item under our consent agenda is an award of contract for the purchase of a 2021 F-150 4x4 Super Cab and X1E to Whitmore Ford Inc. in Mount Joy, PA. They are a CoStars vendor in the amount of $42,950 for the replacement of one of the Department of Fire and Rescue Services Deputy Chief's vehicles. So, Council, that is all the consent agenda items as well as the agenda and the minutes. If there are no objections, these items will stand as approved. Are there any objections at this time? Okay, with no objections, they stand as approved. We are going to move on to the administrative report. We'll welcome the Honorable Abe Amaros and Mayor Moran, not here this evening. He's undergoing some minor medical stuff tomorrow and needs his rest. So we'll welcome Abe. And to the extent we need Frank to join in, Frank as well. So welcome, yes. Abe, and good evening.
Good evening, Council President. Yes, delivering the administrative report tonight will be Frank Dombowski.
Thank you, Council President. Thank you, Managing Director. Good evening, everyone. The mayor does send his apologies for not being able to attend this evening's City Council meeting due to preparation for tomorrow for his medical appointment. This evening, I will be providing just some of the highlights of the city administration report that was already sent to City Council. Some of the highlights from the mayor, Mayor Eddie Moran participated in a flag raising event at City Hall on Saturday, February 27th in honor of Dominican Independence Day. Many council members also attended and participated in the festivities. The Community Development Department attended a meeting with Smart Growth Alliance with the county and several residential developers. The developers shared their views of the market and their interest in the market shift in the city. Community development staff continues to assist Human Relations Commission with the rental assistance program to prevent homelessness. The CD staff is helping with invoice verification, intake, and final approvals. The Information Technology Department is nearing completion of the Penn Street Bridge sign replacement project. This new sign is being delivered to a local installer. It is expected to be ready for installation by the end of March. The Finance Department continues to address the Acela public stuff issues with the Apple software. Until the issue is resolved, residents may access the system through their internet browser at www.publicstuff.com/submit. So it's publicstuff.com/submit. So that it works really well. So if anybody has any questions, the mayor's office or they call the Citizen Service Center if they need that internet browser. And as for the Human Relations Commission, as of February 26th, 843 toll applications for rent and utility assistance were received, in addition of 38 applications since last reported. The Human Resources Department has created an employee newsletter to be distributed throughout the organization every other month. The first newsletter will be released in the upcoming weeks. As COVID-19 vaccinations continue to roll out, the Human Resources Department is leading a work group to create a plan ensuring vaccinations are provided in a timely, appropriate manner within the organization. The Reading Public Library's Southeast Branch will hold a memorial bench dedication on March 23rd at 3:00 in honor of Lisa McCoy. The flyer for this event is included at the end of the report that was sent to council. Also, the Reading Public Library has released the March Youth Programming Newsletter, which is also attached to the report. The Reading Police Department Traffic Division has awarded a $2,500 grant for aggressive driving enforcement in the city. And the Reading Police Department is conducting a joint patrol investigation details targeting gun violence in the city. In an effort to increase the support of these details, the Reading Police Department is working with the Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, the ATF, the FBI, U.S. Marshals, and Vice Task Force on firearm investigations. And finally, the Public Works continues to conduct DID activities. Street sweepers are servicing the downtown regularly when the weather permits. Third shift public work crews are emptying trash receptacles daily. Public work crews are also begun moving equipment and other items out of the former DID office. So that concludes the highlights of the report. And if there's open questions for the administration.
Okay, council members, any questions for the administration relevant to the report? If not, I'll go ahead, Marcia.
Okay, just a question regarding the COVID vaccinations. Was what you referred to just for human resources within the city? Because people are sometimes getting the misperception that the city plays a role in the vaccinations. I've been informed that that's not the case. However, there still is a belief that the city should be doing something. So in any way, we can be helping to get information out, even though we cannot be responsible for the supply or distribution of the vaccinations.
I'll be happy to answer that. First of all, we do have an internal working group that is right now meeting on a regular basis. We had a meeting today, as a matter of fact, to discuss when the vaccines are going to be made available to our city employees. We're still in 1A phase. And many of you saw the article that appeared in the Reading Eagle that showed some of the frustrations with the state not being able to disseminate the vaccinations in a timely fashion to counties, especially those in southeastern Pennsylvania. So we're still dealing with that, and we are providing information. And I want everyone to know that the mayor has already said that he was going to take a leadership role in educating the public, which he has, especially communities of color, where there's a lot of skepticism that still remains with the vaccinations. Of course, he's been hampered severely with his injury, so he's not able to get out there as often as he'd like to, but we are still in the phases of educating the public. So to your point, Councilwoman, we will continue disseminating information. We are not disseminating the vaccines or administering the vaccines ourselves. Obviously, the way this works, the vaccinations are given first to pharmacies, and then they're given to hospitals. And we have been in communication with Tower Health and St. Joe's as well on those vaccinations. So stay tuned. We ask for continued patience. We're not exactly thrilled with the way this has been rolled out either. So we're just asking the members of the general public to continue being patient, and we will continue to provide information as soon as.
And could I just add to that? I think it would be important for the city to recognize those people that have gone beyond the call of duty to be able to help vaccinate residents of the city, and that includes the effort last weekend at the Hispanic Center. The stellar work has been done by Esterbrook Pharmacies to be able to reach out to a lot of our high rises and senior citizens. And I know that Tower Health and St. Joe's are working, but I just think we need to keep recognizing those folks that are really trying to help us to get, or at least at this point, our seniors vaccinated.
Certainly, and I'd like to add that the Berks County Area Agency on Aging should also be commended for its outreach program.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, thank you.
All right, any additional questions for the administration? Go ahead, Donna.
Yes, and I apologize if I've missed this somewhere along the way, but the part on community development with the residential market analyses for the city, I know in my independent writing that I do, my freelance writing, I've come in to some of the information regarding that, and I think tonight Mr. Gonzalez actually presented some interesting information regarding the rise in property values, the 26% per unit rise since 2019. I would request, and again, if this was presented to us via email and I missed it, my great apologies, but if it was not, I would request this be a part of a committee of the whole meeting that we can all learn these analyses, if it's district by district, if it's downtown, if it's industrial, if it's residential. This is pretty interesting information because our property values are escalating rapidly. The days of property, especially residences, are on the market are extremely small. I know in my neighborhood it does like 5 days or so, it seems. And the prices are going up almost on par with what county prices are going up. But I think it would be good for all of us to know a bit more about this because, again, this plays ultimately into our budgetary process because the property tax transfers and the rise of property values, this is going to make a difference as we go into next year's budgeting.
We'd be more than happy to accommodate that discussion, Ashley. Certainly.
If we could get that on an upcoming committee of the whole, that would be great in the next couple of weeks because, again, as the spring and summer comes, that's when the activity in real estate really peaks a bit more.
We'll work diligently to get that on next week's agenda, if that's
okay. Great, thank you.
All right, does anybody else have any additional questions? We'll go to Lucy.
Yes, thank you, gentlemen, for your report this evening. Clearly, all departments of the city are working at full throttle, and it's always appreciated and noted, especially with employee recognition that of last week. My question is specifically towards the DID. I'm very happy that you reported on it this evening because I was going to ask. And in addition to what is currently being done, I think, as Donna just said, with the spring and summer ahead, we even heard it alluded to with Downtown Alive, the beautification of the greening of downtown. These are things that I hope are being addressed by the administration now. so that potentially, you know, the season is upon us. And I'm sure, you know, working with other agencies and organizations and public-private partnerships, but as you have updates on those, it would be appreciated, because anything that we can do, even if it's seeing beautiful flowers this year in our downtown in a strategic way, will help uplift the entire city and everyone in it.
Very good. We'd be happy to accommodate a further discussion on that as well. And fortunately, we've had a lot of people volunteer their services in terms of landscaping, beautification. So we welcome all that input and happy to synthesize that and make a presentation.
All right, are there any additional comments for the administration? If not, we're gonna thank Abe and Frank for the report. And we're gonna move on to the auditor's report. We'll welcome the Honorable Maria Rodriguez. Good evening, Maria.
Good evening, Council President, thank you. The first item on my report tonight is the 2020 franchise fee revenue. As of December 31st, 2020. For the fiscal year 2020, the city budgeted $875,000 in revenue for the cable franchise fees. And the city collected $818,497.20. And for the fiscal year 2020, this revenue line item ended with a negative variance of $56,502.80. On my report dated October 26, 2020, I projected that this year the revenue for the cable franchise fees was forecasted to be on the budget by about $52,000. I was a little shorter. I mean, I forecasted $52,000 and the reality is $56,502.80. The second item is the user fee revenue as of December 31st, 2020. For the fiscal year 2020, the city budgeted $3,196,000 for the user fees, which is the revenue collected for the EMS services that the city provides. However, $58,000 has been added to this budget line item to cover the expense of collections. As of December 31st, 2020, the city has collected $2,405,142.53. And this ended with a short force of $790,857.47. On my report dated November 9, 2020, I communicated that due to the pandemic, the revenue for this line item was going to be on the budget by a few hundred thousand dollars. On February 10, 2021, the city received a check from the Commonwealth PA in the amount of $300,000 for the River Road extension. For the 2020 fiscal financial statement audit is in progress. The city external auditors for buying company has started doing preliminary testing. The city auditor office, along with the finance department, are working diligently in providing all the necessary and requested information that is needed for the completion of this audit. This is my report for tonight, and I'm open for any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria. Council members, are there any questions at this time for the auditor? Okay. If not, again, thank you, Maria, for your report.
We're going to move on to the
next item on our agenda, and that is resolutions for final passage. We're going to do something I don't know we've ever done before, but all five of these resolutions have been requested by the administration to be tabled, at least for this specific meeting. Is there any objection to
us? Ordinances, Jeff, not resolutions.
Yeah, I know. I understand that. Is there any objection to us tabling these as a group, or Linda, do we have to do them one by one?
I think as a group is fine.
Yeah. Yeah, since we're going to make the same motion for all five, does somebody want to Bill 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19, and a general description of all of them is doing some general fund and capital reserve fund, community development fund, sewer fund, cleaning up some bill twos and bill froms. The administration needs a little more time before they finalize those. So they've requested that we table these. I just want to see if there's a motion to table these five ordinances at this time.
So moved.
Second.
Been properly moved and seconded. It's a table motion. We can't really discuss it. So let's get a roll call, please.
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Marmorou to table bills number 15 through 19. Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Gubin-Hendershitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yeah.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, we have 7 ordinances for introduction. I'm going to ask the Councilwoman Marsha Goodman-Hendershitz to please read the record.
Hey, ordinance amending the 2021 waterfront budget by $47,400 to offset an increase for barrier virtue reserve. There was no overall impact on the waterfront operating budget. B, ordinance vacating a portion of Liggett Avenue and removing it from the city's topographical map as requested by the petition presented by the Reading Housing Authority and recommended by the Reading Planning Commission and Public Works Department. C, ordinance amending the City of Reading City Code Chapter 515 Subdivision and Land Development Ordinance Saldo. D, ordinance amending the general fund budget by transferring $123,499 from the fund balance to the agency fund project to finance a comprehensive citywide parking study. E, ordinance amending the general budget by transferring $92,000 from the fund balance to the agency fund for construction costs related to the new 9th and Marion Fire Station project. Ordinance Liggett Avenue intersection realignment and topographical map revision. C, ordinance amending the City Code Chapter 576 Vehicles and Traffic, Part 4, Parking Sections 576 to 404, blocking garage entrances by adding rear parking areas and Section 576-407. Storage of parking vehicles by removing the language regarding the parking of tractor trailers, bringing the section into compliance with the prohibition on tractor trailer parking in Chapter 564.
Okay, thank you, Marcia, for reading them onto the record. We're going to move on then to resolutions. The first resolution is an award of contract for the municipal ERP project to Tyler Technologies at a cost of $1,110,468, utilizing $700,000 available in the fiscal year 2021 and the remaining costs covered next year for the reprogramming property parcel data. This was tabled at the February 22nd meeting. Is there a motion, please?
Motion to table.
Second.
All right, there's a motion to table. There's a table motion on the table. Lily, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Cepeda Freitas, seconded by Councilor Marmorou, to table the award of contract for the municipal ERP project. Ms. Gubin-Hendershitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
No.
Ms. Ventura?
Yeah.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
6 yeas, 1 nay.
All right, our next resolution is reappointing Mr. Steve Belinsky to the Reading Housing Authority. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
All right, it's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Strat?
Yes, Steve has been the backbone of the Reading Housing Authority for many, many, many years. I have yet to call him and not receive a call back if he's not available. And I've been in contact with Steve for the last 25 years. In fact, I think I was one of the first people that appointed him many, many years ago. I was involved with getting him appointed. And I think it's wonderful that you have a man like this from the community that everybody knows, that you don't have to get after him to come back every 4 years. He wants to be on, and he wants to help the people of the city of Reading. Thank you, Steve.
All right, are there additional comments, anyone? All right, if not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmorou, seconded by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz to reappoint Steve Polinsky to the Reading Housing Authority. Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yeah.
Ms. Zepeda-Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, before we move the next resolution forward, because I believe there's going to be a table motion on it, I just want to mention that it's been clarified that precedence has been set that we do not need to confirm the appointment of an acting city solicitor. So we are, I believe someone's going to make a motion to table this. Is there a motion, please?
Move to table.
Second.
Second, okay. It's been motioned and seconded. Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz to table the resolution confirming the appointment of the acting city solicitor. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Ms. Zepeda-Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, Council, that brings us to our final order of business or any administration official, just Council comments. Does anybody have anything pressing they'd like to share? We'll start with Lucy.
So I know it's a long meeting, but yes, I think there are some pressing things. I'll try to be brief. First of all, I want to thank the rest of Council Body, Council President, and the Mayor in support of the advocacy for the Equality Act. And we sent a letter to Senator Toomey and believe that it is very important, encouraging him to make sure that there is no discrimination possible for individuals in the state in which they choose to present themselves. I'm very excited to speak on a community garden that is moving forward in Oak Brook. It has support of many members of the Victory Garden Task Force of last year. We're excited to see this move forward by the community members. I also want to thank the DS Smith, which has locations in both sides of District 1. On Friday the 5th, they invited the police department to join them with an ice cream party in recognition of the service that they do, and also employee recognition, because they do employ a lot of people who walk to work in District 1 and in our city. And again, just to reiterate, there is a youth commission planning meeting this week, Thursday at 5 p.m., that's important because it shows that we are progressing with that youth commission. I believe too that some of the youth violence that we have seen would be a priority topic for the individuals who participate with our youth commission. And last but certainly not least, and most very, very important, today we celebrate International Women's Day. I want to invite everybody to choose to challenge, which is the theme, by raising your right hand. You know, we can recognize that we're celebrating women's achievements. We're celebrating supermajority of women representing the board of our city this evening. We are choosing to raise awareness against bias, and we are choosing to take action for equity. I think it's very important we celebrate and honor and recognize this today and every single day for all of us. Thank you.
All right. Who is our next speaker this evening? Anybody else have any comments? Oh, Johanny.
Steve.
I didn't know if your hand was still up on the pledge.
Yeah, I had my right hand up and then I switched to my left so I can get an opportunity to speak. You know, to follow up on Lucene's great statement and you know, commitment that we all made regarding International Women's Day, I would like to send a congratulatory message, like a special congratulations to Doña Margarita Gonzalez Orlunda de Toluca, Mexico, who is 78 years old and recently obtained her citizenship. So when there's a will, there's a way. Congratulations to the Dominican Association for the work that they do in our community, providing free citizenship classes. And, you know, it's a testament to Doña Margarita that, you know, it's never too late, right, to make some great things happen in our community. Now she can vote, yay, among other things, of course. I also want to send a shout out to Centro Hispano Daniel Torres, Mike Toledo and his team for the amazing work that they got done this past Saturday. I mean, it's a testament to what happens when community comes together to make things happen. Collaborated with the Office of the Area Agency of Aging, with the Reading Housing Authority, and partnered with the Reading Hospital, and they gave they vaccinated 1,100 people. So they took care of our most vulnerable residents of our community. So a big shout out to them for continuing to break down barriers and continue to building bridges for the members of our community. So yes, a big applause to Centro Hispano and to all the great community organizations that we have in our city that continue to do great work despite the pandemic. I just wanted to inform our community that the next project that Centro will be committed to addressing is providing assistance with the rental crisis. They're partnering with the county and the Coalition to End Homelessness to help renters apply for rental assistance. So again, you know, a big, you know, again, thank you community for all you do. So thank you for that.
Jeff?
Yeah, go ahead, Strat. You have a comment?
Yes. You beat me. She beat me to the call. Do you recall the last two council meetings I brought up about getting these shots? And the members of administration said they're coming, they're trying to get them, and I see they're still trying to get them. Well, I was approached last week by Mike Toledo, because he heard me asking for this shot. I want to thank Mike. I want to thank the Latino group at 50 Washington Street. I was treated fabulously Saturday morning. Quarter of eight, I was there. 8 o'clock, I was in. I got my shot, and I was out of there by quarter after eight. And they treated me royally. And again, Mike, tell your group down there, they're doing a heck of a job. Thank you. And thank you for what you're doing in this community. Thanks again, Mike. Thank you, Mike.
All right, Strat, thank you. Marcia, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I have actually several. It's been a real strong time for the community to come together. And I first of all wanted to do a shout out to Pat, who lives at Penn Commons. I was approached from the Hispanic Center and reached out to her, and she got about 15 people from that building identified, and they again got vaccinated down at the Hispanic Center. I also want to thank the Olivet's Boys and Girls Club and working with the village. There is going to be a community event looking at the violence issue this Saturday at 7 p.m. at the Pandora Olivet's Boys and Girls Club. So I think it's most important at this event that the youth be the ones who have their voices being heard. And I know they reached out to the Reading Recreation Commission for them also to identify youth that can come forward. We're moving ahead slowly. We have a lot of obstacles, but I think we're going to come up working with the city administration and all of our connections with the community to turn around the problem of youth violence. That being said, I think you heard what Mr. Centron shared as far as the problem we're having. I'm hoping to hear back from the administration. I just sent out an email with the names of those 100 individuals who were brave enough to put their names on a petition to say, we will not tolerate what's happening in our neighborhood anymore. None of us will. And hopefully the responses come quickly. That place needs to be shut down. There's just no question about it. The sooner that can happen legally, the better. And hopefully that other things can happen, because that owner has no, or it's not the owner of the building, it's the tenant, has no respect for the safety of the community. And we've been violated, and that cannot be tolerated. So hoping to look forward to a positive resolution. On the bright side, even though our Reading Pagoda remains closed, I've been working together with the foundation and Public Works. We're gonna be doing what we can do to make that building come back to its real usefulness. However, what I, one of the things I found, because I've been going up to the Pagoda using social distancing and been meeting people that come up to visit. The highlight last week was a group of 10 individuals from Australia were up there. And I think that that's just a sampling. So what we wanna do is, even though we might not be able to reopen the building, we wanna look at a way to greet people that come far and wide to be able to visit our landmark. So we're gonna be doing some innovative things. I don't wanna go into too much detail about it. The foundation will be discussing it, and we'll let you know as they come about. So have a safe way. And I wanna say, I'm looking forward to my second vaccination coming on March the 18th, and then I will be doing my 3 weeks of continued distancing until the vaccination has its full impact. And but still, as always, wearing a mask and keeping social distance. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Marcia. Are there any other comments this evening from anyone? Go ahead, Donna.
Yeah, and I'll just make this really quick. Supporting what everyone else said about the vaccines, this has been a it still remains a challenge for people. I think we're seeing a lot more open up. In the next few weeks, it will be much easier for people to get them. But even in the people in the 1A category, it has been a challenge with many people from Reading and Berks County driving to, as far as even Columbia County to get vaccinations. So hopefully we'll never have this happen again. We'll never have a pandemic again. But I think it speaks to, on many levels of government, the need for things to have been planned better, to have been organized better, and to have been requested in terms of the number of vaccines. We know Berks County has not received the amount they should have received from the beginning, as well as several of our southeastern collar counties around Berks and out to Philadelphia. That's something we as leaders need to look at, even though it doesn't fall in our purview as city leaders. We need to advocate for our citizens, because if we can't protect and enhance the lives of our citizens, we're not doing our job as public servants. And one other thing I would ask, as the snow melts, it's very obvious along our highways, along our streets, the amount of litter is astonishing. And both on along the highways, bypasses, on our city streets, I drove through. I have to say the downtown looks good. I'm glad to see that. But on my way into City Hall today, I was stunned by the absolute, it was beyond litter. It could have been picked up by shovelfuls along a retail establishment along the route I came in. I will speak with the counselor who represents that area. Maybe there's something that can be done. But this is happening throughout the city. You know, people want to make a difference. And we want to make a difference from the violence standpoint. But with spring coming in our beautiful city with our beautiful trees and our areas, not only should we hope to plant flowers and victory gardens and make it look beautiful that way, but if we can't see the grass because there's so much frickin' litter laying around, and it is happening. I almost had to stop my car and get out and scream today when I saw the one place, because it was an abomination that a responsible business owner lets that happen along their property. Both as business owners and as residents, we have to do our part. If you see something, pick it up. If you see something along the street, pick it up. You know, the weather's getting nicer. I'm gonna get myself one of those rabbit things and walk around and do what our beloved former counselor, John Slivko, used to do. And Jeff, I know you do it as well. But we can show by example, but we also have to ask our neighbors and our residents, please make the city look better. There's no excuse for this. There's no excuse. if we need more containers, let's talk with Steve Harity. Let's see if we can get more containers out there, trash containers. But we talk about seeing a Reading Renaissance. If we can't keep our streets clean, it's going to impact that Renaissance, and it's going to impact those property values that we're so fortunate to see go on. You know, I'm an old farmer. I like to see clean fields and bright green coming up through the grass, through the ground and everything. And yes, Drott, it is getting late, but we do want to see a beautiful spring. So please pick up the litter, pick up what you drop, pick up what someone else drops. Thank you.
Okay, Council, any other final comments before we, all right.
Jeff.
Yes,
Drott. Jeff, yes. If I may, it's amazing. The day after I received this shot, three of the organizations that I had contacted, Marcia gave me the number one place, the VA and another one, a hospital, they contacted me that the shots are available for me. I should call in for an appointment. I thought that was nice. And they did make a nice comment on there at 50 Washington Street. When I told them how old I was, they said, well, that was your birthday yesterday. I said, that's right. They said, man, you look good. I said, thank you. I was 88.
All right. Thank you, Strat. I'm going to real quickly go over our meeting schedule. Next Monday, March 15th, we have a nomination and appointments committee at 4 o'clock. We have a SADO public hearing and a committee of the whole meeting beginning at 5 o'clock. On Monday, March 22nd, we have the committee of the whole meeting at 5 o'clock, immediately followed by our next regular business meeting. That is our meeting schedule as it stands today. If there are no other comments at this time, can we have a motion to adjourn?
You got it.
Thank you, everyone.